Hello everyone, and welcome back to my colonization series in Kerbal Space Program 0.24.2. In this episode, I am aware that we have left two Kerbals on the moon without enough electric supply, and also a rover that does not have any life support. So I wanted to send some sort of vehicle over there that would be able to do many sorts of things, including winching the emergency habitat into a proper vertical position. It also has a container here that has the radial container connector ports, so we can slap some of those onto the emergency habitat so that we can winch it up properly. This only has room for one Kerbal, and we will leave it empty on the way up. It has a carbonite tank, in fact a radial carbonite tanks as well. It has a lot of life support, and which you'll be able to transfer. It has the waste containers so that it can take waste out and dump it somewhere. It even has a tiny little RCS and Oscar B fuel tank, but also, as you saw just there, a thermometer. Now, that's because we needed to transmit or recover scientific data from space around the moon, which we haven't done so far, shockingly enough. And this was the cheapest scientific instrument. A word about prices, by the way. This accelerometer costs 6,000. I mean, just to give a... I mean, not, oh, that's really expensive, but the Skipper only costs less than 3,000. And the LV T30, let's say, is 850, and then the LV T45 is 930. A silly little thermometer is 900. Now I know it has to be shielded from micrometeorites and everything, but still, you know, it's a bit expensive. And these other scientific instruments are very expensive indeed. So yeah, tough to design sometimes. Whoa, that's really orbital mass detector. I'm never going to use one of those. I guess if we get really rich, we'll do that, but not right now. Right now, this entire launch here is 66,000. And I said a note about costs. Get a load of what happens when I put these fairings on. So, there. Oh, 74,000. 8,000 just for the fairings. I mean, it's just not fair. Now, what's going to happen is we're going to be using the orange to bring this little tanker down. So that's why you saw there was a little fuel tank there. And that's because we need to refuel the orange. We also will need some of that fuel for this in order to get it into orbit around the moon. So that will be a thing too. Hopefully we'll be able to get into orbit around the moon without using that fuel, but it'll be pretty close. But we'll do more about the tanker once it arrives at the moon. I say once it arrives because I'm very confident in it. But this is not the only launch we'll do, and because the electric charge is running out on the at the emergency hab, we'll have to sort of launch everything at once and then transfer things over. So, but let's do this one first. All right. So out to the, oh wait, need to check that Jeb has not crept back in. He did, and now out to the launch pad. It'll have to be a nighttime launch again. We don't want to waste any time. Do we have a sense of... Tech life support says there's only 56 minutes worth of electricity remaining at the emergency hab, though. That's a little bit complicated. And, of course, the loss of electricity doesn't mean that it'll all die immediately. So, anyway, but we do want to rush, so let's get the move on this. Off it goes. Ooh, we could probably turn down the throttle there. Okay, going for roll maneuver. Very quick. Hopefully my strut work has got the thing bolted down properly. Beginning pitch maneuver. So of course we're not recovering this stage, and that is because it's going to end up in orbit around the moon, so it'll be one of those that the space tug will have to deal with. And of course, we can only use the space tug once we've unlocked the claw. The claw is necessary. Oh, we can dump fairings, surely. We should cut throttle now. It's getting a little bit out there. Let's see about our location with respect to the moon. Can't do a direct burn. Okay, we've got a good plot here. $500 there, $834 there. How much do we have? Oh, plenty, okay. But we have to also conserve fuel for getting into orbit. Okay, that's that part done. Now, how much do we have left? Okay, so we will only have about 80 delta V in this portion here after we do the trans-lunar injection. And so we'll have to use some from this tank. That's unfortunate. So yeah, this little vehicle carries extra electric charge, obviously. It's got about 3,000. That's probably enough for the Kerbals for a day or something like that, maybe. But it's also got solar panelry. Hopefully we'll be able to get them in daylight eventually. I mean, I don't know how long it takes, but hopefully it doesn't take too long. We'll send more stuff over there. It's only a 6-hour transit to the moon. I think the orange should be heading prograde around the moon, so we have to send this over there the same way. Oops, bit too much there. Tough to do a fine-tuned maneuver with all this stuff, all these rockets. Okay, I'm satisfied with that. Heck, that'll clear the mountains. Okay, so next launch. The next launch is the beginning of our Mun Station aboard the Yakko Wakko launcher, and you can see we've got docking ports here. We've got the OKS docking ports here and on the other end here as well. On one end I'm probably gonna attach one of the multi adapters. What do they look like? Eventually, once it's all settled up, one of these hub connectors will probably go like that. But, yep, we've got life support, and of course we've got the control center and the Kerbitat, so, and some big photovoltaic cells, so, and of course one of these habitation rings as well. Sort of the basics for the start of it, and I'm also going to intend to add an emergency rescue vehicle on here, so some way for the Kerbals to get on and off the surface quickly just in case they do have problems. So but we'll send that up separately because it doesn't really fit into the fairing. These fairings are even bigger than before, and you know what, procedural fairings, if you've got something bigger, it costs more. Now it's 13,000. These fairings are 13,000, almost 10% of the cost of the vehicle, so, and the payload. So yeah. Now this time we're going to try this whole system out again with the parachutes and deploying the airbags. should have known. Deployable airbags. I've got them action grouped. The airbags are on zero. So this, of course, is going to be an expensive launch, but we did a lot of fund management last time. So we've got funds. We will try this. And we'll try and recover this again. See how that works out. Okay. Yep. Save that. And, should I send people up with it? Not just yet, I think. Let's have one commander. You know what? Let's go to the astronaut complex. Find some new people. It is astronaut recruitment time. And I believe the efficiency of the OKS and MKS parts requires Kerbals with low stupidity. I forget if it was OKS, MKS, or KSB Interstellar that had that feature, but I'm gonna go with the assumption that we need to find people with low stupidity. So Chad Bro and John Gus Kerman, get in. Podzer Kerman sounds like serious business. Pepe Kerman, definitely. These others don't seem quite as robust. So okay, let's launch it. We'll have somebody with Pepe. Okay, we'll send Pepe Kerman out. So here we go. Pepe will be in the Colony Control Center, and yep, launch. Okay, well, Pepe is not short on food, water, and oxygen at this point. Looking good. Okay, throttle is up, SAS is on, and we're going to try and recover the first stage, but not before getting everything else into orbit. Alright, does everything look good Delta V-wise? Double check that. This is a pretty heavy payload. A little bit close on the thrust-to-weight ratios here. Okay, good. We'll take it. All right, Pepe is ready to go. And we're off. Oh, lots of wiggling here, probably because of the unwieldy payload. Let's see if we can't throttle back here. Just to keep the payload manageable. Payload fairing separation now. Payload fairings are good. Okay, I'm gonna keep a tiny little bit of juice in this stage in order to, well, if I can even click on the tank in question. And that's a part of the problem that we've been having is tank separating from everything else. But anyway, that's another issue. We're gonna leave that be for now. Okay, good. Read as a separated stage. Okay, we'll coast to Wapwapsis a bit. Let's see about the transfer. Now after this, of course, we need to send some sort of rescue vehicle to attach to this, just in case. So the question is whether to make that a two-person vehicle or a one-person. And I'm tempted to say, for the start, we need a one-person. So what will happen is one guy will get to go into the tanker truck, and the other will get to go into the rescue vehicle here, for now. We'll get larger rescue vehicles once we've got more facilities. Right now we don't have the large docking ports, we don't have numerous other things. For instance, the big solar panels we don't have. Okay, fine-tuning a bit. Okay, good. How much Delta V do we have left? Oh, easily enough to make orbit. So this is all good. Pepe is on his way to orbit with the station. Yep, okay, there we go. Now, if you didn't notice before, I added a little battery here so that we won't be running out of electric charge like we did in previous rounds of this. But the game's still the same. We wait until we flip around. And so, but that's coming up pretty close. Our apoapsis is only 47 seconds away, but we'll still time warp a bit. So the modification this time was I took away two of the parachutes because I figured that it was a little bit too violent the way that the parachutes were opening up. They were ripping this whole thing apart. Another thing might be to simply put struts on. The way these are added to the whole thing might be a problem. So there's a little tank here that they're all actually attached to. And what happened was these parachutes were ripping this tank off from this tank here. And so these all ended up with the tank, but not with any parachutes. So a strut between those might be a thing. Otherwise, I don't know. We'll have to see. Maybe it's the spinning. The spinning might be a problem. Yeah. I could see how the spinning might cause problems for the parachutes. See what the temperature's like. Key thing is, of course, making sure that the parachutes don't blow up. Looks okay. I'm gonna try parachute deployment here. Oh? Okay, looking alright so far. But they're not fully deployed yet, of course. Slowing down. I've dumped all the mass I can. Going to go with the flotation devices, the airbags now. Yeah. Just in case they help some pieces. If this all rips apart, maybe some pieces will survive because of the airbags. Okay, deployment. And 8.9 meters per second. So really just dumping those two parachutes was more or less enough, I think. Unless I might have done something different as well. I'll have to take a look. But 8.9 meters per second is probably too fast still. This is probably going to, but we got further than we did last time, that's for sure. Yeah. Oh, look. Let's recover this. Of course, after recovering, it sent us back to this, so I don't really know how much we actually recovered. Probably not much, obviously. I don't know whether having the entire thing be one tank would be better or worse. It could be that it would be completely destroyed if it was just one tank, or it could be that it would have been saved if it was just one tank. Tough to say. But, of course, right now, the tech tree limits how big our tanks can be, so that's why. That's why it has that limit. And that's good, because otherwise the cost wouldn't be very realistic. We could have a really huge tank for just 4,000 funds. Okay, so we've got a station underway. I want to have the rescue vehicle sent as well. And then everything else will... the arrival of all these will have to be handled in the next episode, I think. I'm running out of time otherwise. So let's try and build and launch a rescue vehicle so that our Kerbals will be able to get from the surface to the station. Okay, so I made a little discovery here, and that's this TAL command pod. I initially thought that I'd be using this lander can, of course, and that's because, well, it's a mainstay. We know all about it, and it looks like the kind of thing that we should be using. But it only has a crew capacity of one, which is why I said I would only be able to make a escape module with only one Kerbal in. But then I saw this. This has a crew capacity of 3. It has the appropriate life support for it, about 18 hours worth. And it has only a little bit more mass. It looks interesting. And so I built around it, and this is what I came up with. So there we have it. This is going to be our rescue module. You see 3,173 meters per second of delta V. We've used really big landing legs, so maybe I should move them up a bit. So hopefully we won't be flipping over. Be around there. Yeah, that looks a little bit more stable. I'm using this little rocket here, the Rocket Max 487S, and that's because it's cheap. It's cheap. It costs only 300. So that was obvious. I think I might actually have added too much solar panelry because these are 100 a piece and we've got all sorts of solar panels here. But I tend to think that solar panels are a good thing. Maybe adjust placement a little bit. But yeah, so it's about 10,000 altogether funds. Which is affordable for something that can carry 3 Kerbals around, I mean from anywhere to anywhere within the Kerbal area. So that's good. Of course, not back to the ground on Kerbal, but I'm planning a ground version. I'm planning a standard capsule version, in fact, using the LV-909 instead, and then parachutes on top. But this is strictly for Mooner use right now, and so we've got docking. We've got the RCS ports and stuff like that. And extra life support just in case. So yeah, I think this will be good. Let's save this as a rescue pod. Okay, rescue pod. Okay, and let me attach it to a launcher. Okay, I decided to quit out and come back in because things were getting a little bit hairy, I felt. Though that might still be a little bit off. But anyway, I've tucked it all into a fairing because the landing legs, I think, are sort of sticking out unpleasantly, so better to keep it all in a fairing so that FMRS space does not become unhappy with us. Don't want to lose the cash, of course. It's only a 53,000, 54,000 fun launch, but still. This is a time when I might have wanted a smaller launch. You know what? Maybe the second stage is sufficient. Let me just set this aside for a sec. Let's see now. I haven't got the other stages all lined up here. Kerbin Express was the full thing, and I guess we should go with 2 because, well, that sounds like it's got things right. Okay. That. Not too far off. Yeah. So I think this will actually be a rescue pod on the wacko. Oh, word about the naming. Yakko, Wacko, and Dot was actually proposed by a user named Multismellahead. I will pronounce it that way. Multismellahead on YouTube comments proposed these names. So that is what we're going with. He or she actually proposed many names. And this is the Animaniacs was the one that eventually decided was a good idea. Okay, let's adjust this. As a base stage, it needs to be adjusted. Oh, but then it'll cost more. Okay, let's But no, I don't want it to cost more. Any way to make it cheaper but still look right? Not really. How much? These cost a lot more, actually. It's good value for money. Let's go to 2.5 on this. It's 2.5 on that. Get the struts right. What the? Oh, I put cameras on these. Well, let's not do that just yet. I forgot I put cameras on the stages. So smooth cone these days, gotta go with that. Actually, now we've reduced to two. Yeah, actually it should be all right now. Let's see. Yeah. And we can go up to 8. Is this enough to transfer to the moon? Not really. This is sort of a weird elongated and squished Yakko stage, but elongated in this direction, squished in that direction. Well, that's obviously too heavy now. That'll work. Nine tons. Actually, this will be cheaper, won't it? Okay, we'll go with this. This is common for me to name stages after the engine anyway, so we'll still call it the Yakko stage. Wacko stage, sorry. Okay, now I want to send one guy in it. We've got two guys on the moon, one guy on the station, and that means two extra seats in here anyway for the people on the moon. So we can send one person. We need somebody courageous. We need, yeah, Richmore. And that'll allow me to see the IVA, if there is one. Okay, so let's go with that. This is a very strange launch. But for something that is meant to send a rescue pod up, it's sort of appropriate. No, that's not what I wanted to do at all. Yeah, I mean, it looks like something that is meant to launch a rescue pod. Definitely. Let's see if this says IVA. Oh, it just has this sort of thing. That's a shame. Okay, but we'll take it. It's still a very efficient way to launch stuff. Okay, so let's see if this thing works. All right, Richmore, get ready for some craziness here. So this is going to become yet another stage in lunar orbit. Richmore does not look too happy right now. I thought he was courageous, darn it. Okay, I think I'll just cut here and coast a little bit. I think we can dump the fairings as well. So, for future versions of this, for versions non-specific to the moon, maybe smaller lander legs? I don't know. I want to be able to send it up without having the fairing, because, like I said, the fairing costs money, and also mass. Maybe there'll even be a version without any lander legs. Sort of looks funny. I'm amused. So, but we've got two seats, and that's two extra seats, and that's the important thing. Oh, it's got productivity. I don't even know what that means. I'm going to have to figure out what productivity means. What does I'm sure it's on some wiki or some forum thing somewhere. Okay, I will look for productivity. You don't have to rain comments on me about that. I have to learn some of this stuff myself. So, yes, we can go to 15 now. Probably even less than that. Okay, we are in orbit, and I am going to make the transfer. Oh, actually, this would have been a pretty good... in this case... Oh, no, that's another thing. Okay. Otherwise, if we had been where the fuel depot is right now, then we would have been in the ideal place for a transfer. It doesn't really look like this is going to make it to orbit around the moon. And I don't want to transfer fuel from here into there. So probably it's going to end up just being... Well, it's going to be ejected into interplanetary space. Well, we're going to use some of it, whatever it has left over, to try and get into orbit around the moon. So we'll see. Maybe it'll end up in a high orbit. Alright, so we have done three launches. One attempted recovery of a first stage. Let's not even say partially successful. The first thing that's going to reach is the little tanker, then the station, then the rescue pod. The guys over at the emergency habitat, they're going to have to switch off the lights and go to sleep, and hopefully they've got enough insulation to keep warm for a while. But yeah, we're going to have to help them out as quickly as possible. The latest mission will be arriving, which is this current one. We'll be hitting periapsis around the moon in 6 hours. So it's basically an overnight thing. With any luck, I don't know if their location on the moon is going to... The whole problem right now is that we don't have RTGs, right? We don't have RTGs and we don't have really big solar panels. We don't even have very big batteries. So that's the obstacle that we're working against. But hopefully we'll get some science out of that one little thermometer to fulfill the contract for transmitting or recovering scientific data from space around the moon. So there'll be that. And then we will continue to do more science around the moon. Well, we'll see about that. All right, so thank you for watching. Please tune in to see how these three missions turn out in the next episode. If you enjoyed this video, please do press like. And if you have any comments or suggestions, please leave them in the comment section below. And I'll see you next time.